nagbigay galang ang palatuntunan ito sa isang kaibigang si Ginoong Noel Perfecto na pumanaw na noong nakalipas na Sabado sa edad na 67. Dumalaw siya sa Tapatan sa Aristocrat mga dalawang Lunes na ang nakararaan at nakinig sa mainit na talakayan. Bagamat tumangging magtanong sa mga panauhin ay lumahok naman at kagalakan ang makita si Noel Perfecto sa audience at nakangiti. May we request everyone to please rise and offer a minute of silence for the repose of Noel Perfecto's soul. Thank you. Good morning, Sky. Magandang umaga sa iyo. Welcome home.
Welcome. Magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat. Good morning. And to our guests today, this is going to be a very interesting topic. Tsaka marami tayong mga media na nandito. So magandang umaga po sa inyong lahat.
We'll begin. Back to business. Pag-uusapan natin ngayon kung nasaan ang mga Pilipino, kumusta na ba sila, pawang hinagpis ba ang kanilang karanasan, bakit maraming walang hanap buhay samantalang maganda ang takbo ng ekonomiya? Ano ba ibig sabihin ng self-rated hunger? Ang mga panauhin po natin ngayon ay pawang mga kagalang-galang at pawang mga may karanasan sa paglilingkod sa lipunan. Subalit, wala sa kanila. None of them is aspiring to be President of the Republic of the Philippines. Wala, wala.
Hindi pala ito yung debate.
Hindi ito yung debate. Oh. So,
halaw part 2 eh.
No, of course. Kasama po natin mga kaibigan, for the benefit of our friends from the Diplomatic Corps, we have with us Mr. Dennis Arroyo, a board member of the Social Weather Stations. He'll give us a briefing in a short while. Narito rin po ang ating kaibigang si Ginang Camrelita Bobby Ericta, dating administrador. She used to be the Civil Registrar General and Administrator of the National Statistics Office. For the first time, kasama natin si Nicco De Jesus, Pangulo ng Marketing Research and Opinion Society of the Philippines. Siya po ay graduate ng UP College of Statistics or School of Statistics some years ago. Hindi ko nababanggitin yung taon, okay? Tulad rin po ni Administrator Bobby Ericta. At si Professor Jerry Eusebio, isa pong lecturer sa larangan ng politika at pamamalakad ng pamahalaan. So, we'll have a short presentation about the surveys. This will be in English.
In English? Okay. Next slide, please.
Next slide.
Next, please. Okay, I want to show the accuracy of the surveys compared to the data, no? Ito, this compares yung green bar, ang combined count, the yellow bar, or the light green, is the SWS exit poll. Compare the accuracy, the combined count with the exit poll. Example, Estrada, 39%. Comelec, SWS, 39%. De Venecia, 15. 16. Rocco, 13.8. SWS, 13.5. Osmeña, Lim. It shows the close accuracy. Okay, ang pagka-asintado ng mga surveys. Next, please. Same thing with the Vice President. 49.6, 50, Arroyo. Angara, 22.1, 21.4. And so on and so forth. Then, next, please. Ito yung mas recent na election. May, the 2010 May election. Aquino, 42. Where's 43? Estrada, 26. 26. Villar, 15, 14, 11, 10. So it's within the 3% margin of error. Okay, next please. Well, same thing, the vice presidential poll, 41, 42. Binay, 41, 42. Ross, 39, 38. Licarda, and so forth, no? Then, can you show yung other presentation, yung part 2, Errol?
Part 2.
The part 2. No, in other words, it shows how surveys are accurate in predicting the public pulse. Then if you want, we can talk later on different things, survey findings. on Pope Francis, public morale, poverty and hunger, crime, public safety, satisfaction with officials, the report card of the ADMI, the opinion poll on the Mindanao peace process, corruption, foreign affairs, and election surveys. If you want to talk about them, we can talk about them. So, yun lang po ang paniwalang remarks.
Thank okay. Doon tayo sa election surveys.
Okay.
How is it done? Because we're as interested as anybody else. Who gets to be number one? And then later on, the next question would be, how influential are these surveys to create a bandwagon effect, if any?
Okay. The global standard is to use 1,200 respondents. 1,200. It's being used in Gallup, in the U.S., Michigan, Roper, all these big institutions. It's being used in Russia, Italy, Spain, Germany, everywhere. Basta 1,200. And you may wonder, how can a small sample of 1,200 reflect the thinking of an entire population? The entire population. It's like tasting soup, no? For example, we have a big kettle of soup, isang kawa ng soup, no? There's no need to drink the entire kettle of soup to taste the soup. You take only one spoon of the soup, one spoon, one sample. Ang mahalaga, dapat the soup should be well mixed. In other words, the teaspoon should represent the entire sample well. Kailangan random ang pagkapili. Okay.
So that is how it goes.
I can go to ensure quality na random, ginagawa yes. Na SWS. SWS uses computer-generated random numbers to choose a sample of random provinces. Okay? Then, in each random province, SWS uses computer-generated random numbers to choose the random municipalities. Then again, third level, random numbers to choose the random barangay. Then random numbers to choose random households. So lahat ng level, random, to get the really accurate survey accounts. That's why you have such accurate findings in the survey.
Sky?
Okay, so ibig sabihin, sir, so with the random na sinasabi mo, not all provinces are involved in the surveys in the Philippines.
Yes, not all provinces. But because of the randomness, nakuha yung public pulse ng lahat. Because of the surveys, because of the randomness, you get the public pulse of the entire nation. And it's true also in the U.S. or Russia or any big country.
So this is computer-generated?
Yes.
All right. Magandang pag-usapan ito eh. How different is this from the research that you do at... How do you do it in the Marketing Research and Opinion Society of the Philippines?
Okay. Public opinion polls as an instrument for getting representative responses to whatever decision needs to be made by marketers. So MORES stands for the Marketing and Opinion Research Society. And we service clients who are marketers, okay? In the case of SWS, they are opinion surveyors and their clients mostly are strategists and government, politicians. Both sides of the coin have a decision to be made. Because we need to understand get feedback from consumers in the same way that SWS needs to get feedback from constituents, as much as possible, we could get the views of all consumers who are targeted. In the same way, politicians need to get feedback from all constituents of whoever politician they're surveying. Ideally, we have someone like Bobby Ericta, no? Every time magsa-survey, 100% census, right? Nothing will beat that. 100%, you have 100% feedback from all consumers for our target market, for all constituents of whoever politicians being served. But we don't have that money. See, Bobby will tell you more or less how much one census will cost. Mom, how much more or less?
2.6 billion
pesos. Okay? So for a marketer, who won't have 2.6 billion pesos, what's the next efficient thing to do? A sampling survey. And the price we pay for not giving a census is what we call the margin of error. No? So that's universally done, MAPA survey research for opinions pollsters or marketing research pollsters. Okay, so for brand A, mag-isip kayo, telco like Globe or Smart or Sun, for example, no? They don't have 2.6 billion, right? But they have enough to get an accurate sample, and they're willing to trade off that cost for that information. Ano ba yung gusto ng consumer for my brand? No? So methodologically, we're the same. But we do surveys. Ang catch is, how is it done? Kasi sabi nga po ni Dennis, dapat well-represented po ang sample. The sample should be well-represented. No? So you don't need to drain the entire body of blood to get the sample, the blood type. No? Kailangan is just one pinprick, right? That's the heroic assumption for sampling. So kung hindi po scientific, marketers will not listen to us. If it's not scientific, they won't give you that accuracy that was shown on the first slide that you saw earlier. No, that's the first slide showed they had an error of about 1.3% for just 5,500 sampled individuals, right? They didn't have to ask all the voters. No, mahal yon. So we share the same discipline, and because of that, it's something that we need to protect. No? Okay, so why? Because in a democracy like ours, representation is key. I think that's what democracy is about. No? Yeah. Like as a press, we want freedom of expression. In the same way, we want representation. Okay, that's it, sir.
Thank you. Administrator, let me ask you, how many Filipinos are there today? Would you have any idea? And how many of them have registered to become voters for the coming elections?
Malamang mga 100 million na ngayon, ano? O mahigit pa. At yung mga nakarehistro ay more or less 55 million. 18 years old and over. Uh-huh. Gusto ko lang dagdagan yung sinabi ni Nico.
Wait, paki-English natin lang konti.
Okay.
Medyo English muna.
Okay. I agree with Nico and Dennis about the need for representation. When we do sampling, we have to give up some things. We cannot insist on having a small sample and then try to get barangay level data. That's the trade-off. So the more levels we introduce, like for example, if we want provincial level disaggregations, the more samples we need. That's the catch. So don't expect SWS or Morris to be able to tell you that in this small municipality in Cagayan, this is the trend. Because the sample will not allow you to provide accurate nor reliable estimates at that level.
Okay. Will the Christmas tree type of population still hold true today?
Yes, Melo, the Christmas tree is still there, but it's getting a bit slimmer.
Yeah.
At the bottom.
At the bottom. So the bulk of Filipino voters today are from 18 to 24 years old?
Millennials.
Millennials. Okay. So given...
Those who have biometrics. Really? Those who forgot to go to the COMELEC to have their biometrics done cannot vote.
So no.
Okay. Yes, please.
I want to stress the point that it's a trade-off, no? in the private sector, you have fast surveys, but a small sample, fast surveys. Okay, while sa public sector, less frequent surveys, but they can go into detail. Okay, they can go down to the provincial, municipal level. Yung private sector cannot do that. So you use both types, though, both the public and the private.
Maganda ito eh. Pero paano yun? Like for example, in your case at SWS, you have this survey about self-rated hunger. How do you do it? Do you ask people if they are hungry when the survey was taken?
And what does it mean?
Yes.
Yeah, precisely.
Are you hungry? Yeah, yes. I'm dieting. No, yeah. No, it is an involuntary hunger. Not dieting, no? It's an involuntary hunger. Yeah, we ask the people if they were not, if they experienced not eating, if they experienced not being hungry from not eating because they could not have food. Yes. And that shows up. That shows up in the data. The data show that it was going up and then now it's going down under Pinoy because I think lower inflation and the CCT program, the Pantawid Pamilya program, seems to be kicking in.
Really? Okay. So maganda to. This is something interesting. What has the academician got to say about all this? I'm sure you have some opinions. Well, and you will not just agree.
First of all, thank you for calling. Well, I've been teaching intermittently for about 20 years already, but for the past 3 years, I've been teaching more or less continuously for 3 years, but still part-time. So I don't know if that would qualify me to be called an academician.
That is okay. That's all.
It sounds good. But I would be more interested in my other like, of course, aside from being an academician, as you so, how would I say it, nicely put it. I was also involved in campaign management or campaign consultancies since 1995, for every 3 years, po. And since 1995, we've been, you know, using SWS and, you know, and the other...
Pulse Asia
results, always. No? It has been, you can't go on without it, really. We're actually dependent on it. Of course, there are other outfits, but they're okay, but we have proven them actually less accurate than SWS and Pulse Asia. But I was just thinking that perhaps it depends upon the type of elections. For instance, in senatorial elections, it would be easier to, Dennis, if during senatorial elections, mga 11 out of 12 normally tama eh, no? Yung resulta na, yung huling-huling survey before the actual elections of Pulse Asia, even 100% sometimes. 11 out of 12, meaning kung iba naman, notches lang ang diplensya, let's say a senatorial ball would be, instead of number 10, number 11, yung ranking lang. So that's how accurate they are. But in presidential elections, I think there would be a bit of difficulty perhaps because of the plurality of, the tendency towards plurality. So that's my concern. Well, it's my comment.
Okay. Would you say name recall is really that important?
Yes, very much.
Okay. Whether it's good or bad recall, as long as people remember you, that's okay?
Yes. You mean not too negative, though?
The case of Pacquiao.
I think that's I haven't really studied that, but I think that might create a dent. I mean, in his standing, maybe he would still win, but maybe 11, maybe, you know, it would maybe, I don't know. I really haven't studied the numbers.
Let's leave it at that. Yes.
SWS also surveys yung awareness or name recall of the candidate. And I saw a positive correlation between awareness and approval ratings. So it shows, it's a factor. Name recall or awareness, as we call it, is a factor in winning.
But it's different from acceptability, right? They may be aware that a certain candidate is a candidate, but would not vote for him, right?
It seems to me that large awareness means the candidate is doing his homework in being public. In the candidate is being visible in public, so he's doing his work. So it seems that that's the reasoning behind it.
If I may add, Melo, maybe what may be worrisome to some is because of the tightness of the race, for instance, in the Senate, in the senatorial category. What will happen is, in view of what we call the bandwagon effect, you know, kung lagi ka nasa TV or nasa radio, let's say ito yung resulta nung inabas, it would, it would have an effect on voters because according to some, traditionally voters are love winners and they prefer, the Dalyamado phenomenon.
Okay.
And that was it.
Okay. Let me ask you, Nicco. Some people believe that the surveys would establish a bandwagon effect. At the same time, it will encourage funders to go after the most viable candidate. So at which stage of the survey would this prove to be true?
Actually, I'm itching to show you a framework which I just showed in Baguio. If it's okay with
it's
you.
Okay. So okay, please. All right.
Okay, on the bandwagon effect, SWLS did run some surveys to test if there's a bandwagon effect or an underdog effect. That is bandwagon effect. The guy's leading, so I'll vote for him. The underdog effect is he's trailing, he's lagging behind, he's the underdog, so I'll vote for him. Okay, so the bandwagon effect versus the underdog effect. It turns out, wala. They cancel each other out. The bandwagon and the underdog cancel each other out. So it's the in effect, there's no effect because they cancel each other out.
Like in this case of presidential elections, how many times do you do the survey? So, ilang beses siya?
Now, because the elections nearing, we'll do it not monthly. Now we'll do it monthly before quarterly, but now in the run up, we'll do it more frequently or monthly.
And how much does it cost you?
Sorry, I don't.
Okay. Confidential, siguro. Sorry, I asked the question. Yes, please. You're ready with the framework? Okay. Yes, please. Okay. Paki-plug na lang, patulong na lang, ano? Maganda to eh. Alam po ninyo, itong Mores ay ka-tie up ng Philippine Press Institute and they've been going around the country giving seminars to publishers and newspaper men about surveys, about elections, and how to behave. But I know statistics as the palm of your hand, Administrator Bobby. Saan naroon? Where can we find the most number of people in the Philippines? Where are they, according to provinces?
If it's by region, it's Calabarzon. Okay. Calabarzon is the most populous. Nandiyan din yung malalaking provinces, Cavite, Batangas. But we can talk about a corridor. From Region 1 down to the Mindanao Island, starting with Pangasinan. Uh-huh. Pangasinan and then Central Luzon, Pampanga, Bulacan, Nueva Ecija, uh-huh. And then down Batangas, Cavite, Laguna.
Rizal
is small because Metro Manila ate it up.
Ah, really?
Yes, it used to be one of the largest, but now Makati is already Metro Manila. Mandaluyong is already Metro Manila, and so on. So, ang natira sa kanya, Pililla, Halahala, yung mga small municipalities.
Okay.
And then you go down to Quezon, Camarines Sur, Leyte, down to Iloilo, Negros Occidental, Oriental, Cebu, Bohol, and then Bukidnon.
Are you saying that 40% of the voters are within Lingayen to Lucena corridor?
Mm, yeah. Yes.
Okay. You tend to agree, Dennis?
Yes.
Yes, usually because of Metro Manila sucking up everything, we're a big magnet, and you can see the effect on traffic and the congestion and all that. No, so you have this urban-rural migration, and then so at least Caraverson is also there. Now it'll be ideal to decongest traffic, hopefully, by developing Clark Subic the north and Caraverson the south as a magnets to draw people away from NCR.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Nico.
Just to add to that, maybe you should check the Philippine Statistics Authority website. You will see that the average density of the Philippines is about 333 people per square kilometer, whereas that of Metro Manila is about 18,000 per square kilometer. So you can just imagine, the density is, as what Dennis was saying, sucks up the voting potential. Okay. I have some here, prepared some slides, which we've been presenting in different parts of the country to different media, local media. And just to set the landscape, we value surveys as a medium for self-expression. Next slide. Here you have countries where we neatly map out values in terms of how they relate to self-expression. That's towards the right side, and survival towards the left side. Forget about the y-axis. Well, the y-axis is about ones who are traditional, meaning they listen more to elders, to religion, etc. Whereas in the upper of the ones on the top are those who listen to reason. Anyway, Philippines is right smack in the center, and you can see that we're lumped, not alongside with other Asian countries, but with countries like Guatemala, Ecuador, Colombia, Mexico. So culturally, we belong to the other side of the planet. No? And what I did was to plot out the state of embargoes of surveys. Embargo means you hide the surveys just before the elections, for example. The study was prepared, the embargo records were prepared by the University of Hong Kong and was presented to the Weipor 65th anniversary. Yes. I'm sure C. Dennis knows about that, and Silam, all other Weipor pollsters knows about this. And it was a study done amongst 185 countries. As you can see, Philippines is one of the Latin American countries which has zero embargo, and which I think we should feel happy about. No? Next slide, sir. Next slide. One punch. Yeah. So in takeout lang is that, you know, we have to understand surveys in a much deeper level, because this is a way of channeling people's voices as a means of feedback. If we understand it just at the surface, we lose out on the full benefits of feedback. No? Next slide, sir. And we prepared a very simple framework of how to understand surveys. Merong consumer, merong or constituents, in the case of SWS, that's the left side. Sa kabila, you have the marketing decision maker, the ones who make a decision. And right smack in the middle are the surveys. That's the tool so that you can listen to the consumer, to the constituents. One down, sir. Now, what can go wrong? Okay, so one down, sir. On the side of the marketing decision maker, misuse of surveys. That's a huge bunch of issues still not talked about, no? On the, just before the survey reaches the marketing decision maker, surveys which are badly told, which are badly communicated. What are these? These are presentation issues, no? In the same way that representation is important, presentation is equally important, no? And on the survey, we have, obviously, bad surveys, di ba? Badly done surveys, badly sampled surveys, badly questioned surveys, badly translated questions, okay. And then, what do you have if the you have misuse of surveys, surveys that are badly told, badly represented surveys. Ang nasa dulo, bad decisions. But consumers will start not trusting surveys at all. To the point that, you know, they can tell government, please regulate surveys. Please restrict surveys. Which is why some countries have restricted surveys already. Why? Because of the three boxes that you have on the right. Okay? Now, if we're going to safeguard this, and if we believe that we're going to be like, you know, the 16th richest country by 2050, we have to start doing our homework now. If it's going to be a strong nerve center, we're going to be part of a strong knowledge economy, we have to do this now. No? Now we have to do good data, and we have to understand data at this level. Okay, next slide, sir. Oh, next slide. Okay, now I answer the question, sir. Si Melo was asking me yung bandwagon effect. Okay, since surveys are snapshots of feedback, magkakaroon ng survey ngayon, and since it is sampling, okay, the studies that we encountered sa WAPOR, sa SMR, even sa brand studies show that this is a very small part of it. It only affects consumers' decisions minimally, if at all. No? If for me, it's important that I have a job, if for me, it's important that I have income, no? Or opportunities for my kids to go to school, I will not be affected by surveys. I will vote that person who will give me income. I will vote for that person who will give education to my kids. So, and the same thing goes for brands, no? Pag nag-survey kayo, tapos nakita nyo ang brand X is angat by like 60% over brand Y, but brand Y is available in the supermarket where I live, I don't care about brand X at all. No? So, may bandwagon effect ba? Well, it's, to me, it's like good to know knowledge. Now, the thing is, some pollsters make use of surveys wrongly. No? In marketing research, they call it sugging or sales under the guise of research. Magre-research sa bahay, kakatok, they knock on the door, they present the questions, and then at the end, can you please buy brand X? That's called sugging. No? That's been around for a long time already. Okay, meron ding push-pulls. Now, yung push-pulls is also something that we're against. No? And we're all doing this because we want to protect the craft, as I mentioned earlier. No? So ito po, or maybe some, si Dennis might want to share something about that, but on the bandwagon effect, studies would show that very minimal. Maybe we can do a separate presentation just for that.
Okay. Yes, Dennis.
Example ng bad surveys are online surveys, online, because you can vote as many times as you want. You can click as many times as you want. So you can affect all the findings.
So pati yung Miss Universe, pwede ma-question. Oh, diba?
But there are programs, ha? There are programs na one time ka lang pwedeng mag-vote.
Ayun, na-develop na yun. Pero yung mga survey kuno sa radyo, yung mga text surveys, how do you look at it?
No, we don't trust those surveys because they depend. Those who bother to call are those with strong feelings. Okay, so if you call, it means you have strong feelings. So now we filter only those who are, say, for this candidate or that candidate will bother to call up. So ang talagang accurate surveys, the usual face-to-face survey na ginagawa ng private sector and government.
Okay, because there used to be questions asked of radio stations, of the radio audience, and they respond through text. And we know some politicians are, you know, of evil minds, can immediately send 1,000 text messages, no? And that's technology. All right. Madam Babi, tell us about the population today. I'm as interested as anybody else. If you have 100 million Filipinos, how many of them may be considered poor?
Nako, you know, I've been out of the loop, ano? But I think Nicco is more, Nicco would be more, would have that at his fingertips because he's into marketing, so he yeah. should know his...
The latest data I have on poverty is from 2012. It's a 75-page report written by Toots Albert, and it has not been superseded yet. But anyway, Nico, what do you have?
Okay. For the past 3 years, we're preparing the what we call the Morris One Sec, which is it's gotten a life of its own. I can talk to you about that in some detail later on. But we now have instead of the usual five cuts are A, B, C, D, E. No, the Morris One Sec study, which was a 4-year study, showed that we have not five cuts, but 9 cuts. Of that 9 cuts, and we're basing it on a 36,000 sample study using the Family Income and Expenditure Survey, we would have what we call the lowest expenditure clusters at the lowest, and that's about 18% of the country or of total households are considered low expenditure. The Philippine Statistics Office, the Philippine Statistics Authority, definition of poverty is more or less in that area, no? That's a 1 in 20 are considered poor. The definition is driven by the whether or not they consume the threshold nutrition and the basic commodities, no?
Yes, the definition is that whether their expenditure is above or below a certain threshold, which we call either a food threshold for the ultra-poor or the poverty threshold for the poor. So yun yung minimum na requirement ng katawan to stay healthy.
Okay. The reason I ask is if a worker gets 500 pesos a day, more than 50% goes to food, right, Madam Bobby?
Yes, but that 500 depends on where you are, because if you look at the wage rates, 500 is minimum in Metro Manila, but it is twice the minimum in, say, autonomous region of Muslim Mindanao.
Yeah, and of course, if you get 500 pesos in Manila and you spend 250 for food, and then you spend a pretty sum for transport, then there's nothing left, right?
Yes.
Now, if there is nothing left, chances are, pagdating ng election, vote buying will be very popular.
Well, they will be tempted.
And chances are they will give in.
Ano yung sabi ng ibang kandidato? Take it, but vote for your candidate.
Oh, yeah. Yung bang income ng isang tao can affect yung decision niya to sell his vote? Yes.
Most certainly.
Operator kayo, no? Opo.
Hindi naman sa news tayo sa local elections, pero matalas na nangyayon sa local elections. Sa national po, party list, vice presidential, senatorial, president, wala akong vote buying doon.
Mr. Vice
Leader.
Or the local elections.
Local elections po nangyayari.
Vote
buying. Ano ba yung nangyayari pa rin? Pero hindi pa po ako nakaka-randa sa actual experience ng ganoon. Pero ang point ko, talagang meron yan, lalo na sa mga probinsya.
Sa mga probinsya. Coming from SWS and Wallace, okay. Yeah, I want to stress though about that. You mentioned yung pag-suppress ng surveys. Because, okay, we are a democracy. We have a freedom of speech. So this freedom to speak implies the freedom to listen. That's why SWS won a Supreme Court decision guaranteeing the freedom to listen, the freedom to the polls or politicians. How do the people speak? They speak during elections. They choose the candidates, but elections are held only once every 6 years or once every 3 years. Between the 6 years, how do you speak? Via the surveys, SWS and other pollsters, we gather public opinion like a radar dish. okay, in a radio edition ng bayan, gathering opinion, then feeding the opinion back to policymakers. So we, that's a democratic function in between elections.
Okay. Yes.
We don't have. We're not. We don't see vote buying in sa marketing research, no? Hindi na yung maisip yan. But, sorry.
Consumers.
Sorry.
Defensive.
Ah, no. Okay. Ay ba? Yeah.
Any marketing.
Yeah. But I'd like to, to write on the point of Dennis, no? Election, that's correct, no? 6 years yung wait time. 6 years is a long wait, no? So there's, there are two things here. So supply side, the politicians, no, they're aware that the stakes are high. I won't get another election the next month. I have to wait for the next 6 years. So talagang I have to increase, no, my chances, no. Some would probably local, I'm not speaking for others, no, might have to buy votes, no. Now the crux is yung vote botante. Will he trade off that 6 years na wala na naman siyang trabaho with that one day na he will just give his vote?
One day millionaire.
No? One day millionaire siya. No? So the campaign has to be on that, on the electorate or the constituents. So
I agree with you 100%. No? Yun ang kailangan na, that's what we need now. Actually, yung para, I don't know if it's called voters' education or something like that. Some say, some get hurt. Some say, no, they're not. I know they're not. Because actually, correct me if I'm wrong, Nico, but they tell us about 65% belong to the CDE, something like that, classes. So what happens actually is most strategists or campaign headquarters, what they do is they target the 65% and they try to, you know, they just try to woo the 65% just for the sake of winning. I mean, it's a numbers game. But you are also very correct, like, of hindi naman 6 years, bali 3 years, kasi presidential, normally pag presidential, it's not 6 years and vice presidential. Pero ganun din eh, yung mga mayoral and gubernatorial, that's 3 years, and that's a long time also. I mean, you wouldn't trade, you know, let's say 500 peso or even 1,000 pesos, even 2,000 pesos siguro, for just, you know, for 3 years of misery. Di ba? But okay. Sometimes, well.
All right, thank you.
Can I just add to that? No? Kasi I want to bring the discussion even more forward. No? I think the reason for having that disparity of trade-off and risk is the absence of information. No? For years and years and years, election after election and after election, our information, it only comes during election period. Diba? It's only election period that we have information about this candidate na hindi naman about performance. It's a marketing ploy, it's a positioning statement. Now, if you reverse the coin, however, if you flood the market with constant information, in the same way that we know about interest rates, foreign exchange, day in and day out, let's say every month you know where this candidate stands in terms of performance, where this candidate stands in delivery of his promises, for example. If there's a barangay index, more or less, how can he, for example, on election day, escape? Now, there's a running average of performance, right? And therefore, the temptation for pesos versus ano becomes smaller, much less, kasi meron ka ng benchmark by which this person or this party is put against. No? So, I'd like to elevate it to that issues, and the only tool that's lacking is availability of information or tools for that matter.
So, in that case, may kandidatong nananalo dahil hindi kilala ng tao.
Or nakikilala lang on that day and kasi
maganda magsalita. Oh. Magaling.
Congratulations.
May ganon.
Magaling. How's that?
Yes, well, ano na yun, value added na yun. Like if the guy knows how to speak and all that, so plus meron pa siyang Santa Claus syndrome, whatever. Or, then winner na yun, di ba? Most likely, because if you look at the old paradigm. But as Nico has said, if we bombard the electorate with the proper information, not only that, but yung campaign finance reforms, mag-isip tayo, hanggang saan ba yan dapat? Yung TV ads, dapat pampayagan lahat na ano, kung may pera ka, bumili, yung mga ganun. I mean, a host of many, you know, maybe we should talk about it.
A bit later, yeah, we'll talk about it next time, yes.
Yes, Nico, underline the importance of issues. So it's important for the people to tell the politicians what issues matter and how are they performing. Kailangan may report card on the issues, on many things. It's also there in my report card. Number 6, report card on the national admin, if you want to see it.
National
lang yan.
Yes, please.
Yun nga yun. Sa national level, we have report cards and other surveys. But as Jerry said, the problem is in the local. So who will do that at the local level? Well, we have done some small surveys, but these are commissioned, so I cannot identify those surveys. But one thing we found out when we asked them what would be an ideal candidate, and you know, the most number of respondents said, madaling lapitan. So, transactional pa rin. So, I think...
So, kung gano'ng madaling lapitan, talo na si Marrojas.
Mahirap ba lapitan si Marlo?
Oo nga.
Diba? You know, perception eh.
Oo.
Oh, diba?
So, but, you know, if we want to influence decision making, we should listen to the surveys and do something about it. Diba?
Okay. Yun humang pagpapasa ng, ano, sibuyas, okay na ba yun? Will it add?
Ewan ko, Jerry.
Paano po yan? Sibuyas bill?
Pagpapasa ng sibuyas. Pagpapasa ng ano, magmamotorsiklo, walang helmet.
Sabi naman ni Mar, hindi naman yata daw. Parang na-photoshop yata. Yung, isa pa yun, ano, yung, well, that's another matter, yung sa Facebook. Pero gusto ko nang dagdagan, yung panahon nung nasiraan si Jesse Robredo, meron siya mga reforms sa DILG noon na sinasabi niya, parang good housekeeping. Yung mga ganun, para sa local governments to, ha? Di ba, mga seal of good housekeeping. Seal of ganyan. Na would be some kind of indicator if this local government official is doing his job or not. Pero hindi lang masyadong, ano, well, hindi masyadong visual at ano. But kahit pa paano, may mga parang simula na. But it's very true. Pagka-election lang natin na pag-uusapan minsan yung ganito, ano? So I think we should do something about this.
With that information po na sinabi niyo na kailangan masabi na mabombard na sa mga tao, who should do this? Who do you think should do this? Yes.
Well, it's going to be a grand experiment, no? Kasi wala pa talaga. But I understand Filipinos are well known for their ingenuity, di ba? May values tayo for free speech. We're kasi it's like this. Television, you have a third party who does the survey ratings for them, right? So they're trusted. Likewise, pagdating sa census, you have the Philippine Statistics Authority to do the job for them, right? Now for the local, we'll have to talk about it. Diba? Kasi yung academe is very active. No, when I was in Baguio last week, they were volunteering to do this for yung the Kalinga groups. No, magkakaroon sila ng parang pilot study, pilot panel research to track performance. No, so that's just Baguio. So hindi ko alam kung ano pa ibang ideas na lalabas.
Pero yung sinabi ni Jerry kanina, na in the guise of awarding good performance, in effect, we are also giving feedback to the constituents about the performance of their leaders or their executives. So that, you know, if you say Galing po ako winner for several years.
Hall of Famer na yun.
Hall of Famer na. So they must be doing something good.
Yeah, I remember during the time of Alex Brillantes at the local government academy, I asked him, we know the secrets to success, but can you give us yung inyong significant failures? Dahil we'd like to learn from them, bakit hindi sila umasenso? Bakit hindi sila magaling? So aside from giving credit to the good performers, might as well do case studies for the failures. Maganda mag-usapan nyo. We'll open the floor to our friends from the media. From the from Opinion, the columnist, Lingoy Alcuas.
Good morning. May mikropono. Hindi po kailangan. A premise and an aside before my question. Kasi po kanina, nag-imply po kayo.
Inglesin po ninyo. May bisita tayong foreigner.
Okay. Okay, it's a bit hard to go back to English after trying to leave it. After trying very hard to learn Tagalog and leave it behind. Okay. Just an aside, I learned my Filipino speaking abilities by delivering speeches in Visayas and Mindanao to the fury of Senator John Osmeña. Okay. Anyway, Mr. Melo Acuña earlier was implying the weight of the Lingayan to Lucena corridor. Okay, if we go back in history, we only had President Osmeña, President Rojas, President Garcia, and I think after that, no more, from the Visayas. If I remember my demographics when I was young, it appeared that the population of Visayas and Mindanao was proportionately bigger than it is today. Now, another aside. I'm sorry for the many asides. Okay, but as one of the conveners and the first Deputy Secretary General for Luzon of PDP Laban, we had to live with the reverse of Imperial Manila. We had the Imperial South because the voting, the votes in our National Council were one-third Luzon, one-third Visayas, and one-third Mindanao, as opposed to the present more than 50% population of Luzon. So, my question is this. Sorry for the long premise. I work at the Public Information Office of the City of Manila, and recently when I had the opportunity to talk to, for example, police station commanders in Tondo, I asked them this question. Sabi ko, nung bata ako, sorry, when I was young, in the Tondo low-income areas, depressed areas, no, there were clear delineations of communities of Warais, Cebuanos, Ilonggos, etc., etc. Okay. So I asked them, how is this today? And they said that nag-fuse na, naghalo-halo na. No? And so my question is, do you have figures or do you have analysis for the assimilation of the immigrants? Because naturally, I think the reason why Luzon has now a higher proportion is not because we are more, we have more prolific, more libido, and more fertile, but rather that there is more immigration from the south, even though it's more difficult to travel from the south than from neighboring regions in Luzon. Thank you. Sorry for the long.
It's okay. Yeah, migration. Madam Bobby.
Yes, we know that Metro Manila, especially, is an in-migration area. So that's why you have Warais and Bicolanos and Visayans in our neighborhood. My neighborhood, there are a lot of people from Leyte. So migrants from Leyte.
From Leyte. Okay.
So but on the other hand, if you look at Visayas or Leyte in particular, Region 8, it's an out-migration area. So that sometimes when you look at the population growth rate, sabihin mo, bakit negative? Negative ang growth rate. It's not because people are dying left and right, but because they are leaving. That's why Batanes, up to now, is only 16,000 population. Because once they finish their schooling, the young people tend to migrate out. So, yun ang ano doon. The thing is how to reverse the process. To ask them to go back to their hometowns.
Yeah, but the answer would be, ano, bali, uuwi pa ron, eh, andito na sa Manila. Why should we go home when we're already in Manila? It has to be attractive.
Without too much analysis, I think we know that the Bicol region is also relatively unwell off, especially because of the typhoons. Then we also know that the Cagayan Valley, in spite of its very big land areas, no, is also relatively backward, at least in terms of incomes of people. And the Ilocos region has a very narrow coastal strip, and so they lack land. But considering that these three regions, outward immigration from them can just take the bus. They can take aircon bus, they can take non-aircon bus. It's very cheap and very quick compared to taking either a boat or the bus from Mindanao and Visayas that gets stuck at the ferry points in Matnog, Allen, etc., etc. So why is it that in migration from the south seems to be beating in migration from within Luzon or the extremities of Luzon? And why is it that in the past so many Ilocanos went to Mindanao, which is far, far away? Thank you.
Maganda yan. Yes, madam.
It's more of economic opportunities being present in the place where they migrate. For example, when the Ilocanos went to Mindanao, it was because Mindanao had the promise. Diba sabi, it's the land of promise. And the Ilocanos being very
industrious
and adventurous at the same time, were willing to go to a new land where they might get rich. And they did, most of them anyway. On the other hand, the people from Cagayan come to Manila, but they can easily go home. If they don't like it, they can easily go home. What also drives them to come to Manila is economic. For example, we found out that while the government is talking about... Wala na ako sa gobyerno. While the government is talking about...
She's no longer with the government, that's why.
The need to improve the agricultural sector by mechanizing and so on and so on, they seem to have forgotten that there is this group of farmers, landless farmers, who tend to lose out if the landed farmers mechanize. Because who will now harvest the rice? In the past, it was the landless workers who were helping the landed farmers to harvest. But now, it's the kubota or the reaper, whatever you call it, and the landless farmers no longer have work. Okay, so what do? They burn the... But they should be given opportunities within their own hometowns.
And that is what we failed to listen to last night from the presidential polls.
Oo nga.
Sad to say. Yeah. More questions from the floor, from the media? Yeah. Yes, please. Yes, please.
Ang tanong ko lang po for SWS.
Please identify yourself.
My name is Joy Dian Gumate from PTV4. So my question is especially from the SWS. So when you conduct the survey, how were you able to encourage the random participants to really participate? Do you provide them with the reason why they have to participate and the purpose of getting their opinion firsthand, especially about the upcoming elections?
Do they get paid for replying?
No.
They don't.
No incentive, no gifts, no money. They're sheer pangulit, sheer persistence in going to the house and coming back. No financial incentive.
But do they ask questions? Why me? Why do I have to participate? Will they make a difference if I participate or not?
No, they tolerate our service.
But do you usually explain to them the reason behind everything?
Yes. They okay. The FI, the field interviewer, has a card which they read yung kahalaga, the value of the survey. Okay, why else? How you chose it, etc., etc. My script. So they read that, but talagang walang financial incentive.
But sir, can you give us a general idea? Ano po yung purpose na sinasabi nyo, explaining to the people why they have to participate? If just the general.
I won't memorize the script, no. But magandang hapon po, kami po yung mga we are interviewers of SWS, isang survey group sa Pilipinas. We value your opinion. It's important for you to tell us, and we to tell everyone, the government, the media, and everyone, what your opinions are. Okay, so the value of the opinion, and then especially now, na malapit na malapit na yung election. Yun lang po.
Do you get to identify them in your surveys? No names.
No, may names, but we don't share the names with others. It's nakatago lang sa database.
Ah, okay.
But can they say no as well if they don't want to participate?
They can say no, but then magaling magulit ang mga interviewers.
Ah, okay, pero sa NSO, pinapahabol yata sa aso pag minamalas-malas, di po ba? May nakakagat kayo ng aso, enumerators, right?
Hinahabol din yung aso.
Ah, ayun. Okay. So they also run after the dogs.
No, but may I also make a comment about that? In our experience, it's very easy to conduct surveys in outside Metro Manila. Outside Metro Manila. Yes, they're very cooperative. They even serve you merienda. But in Metro Manila, you have identified the respondent. You're face-to-face with the respondent, and still he will say, he's not here, so it's difficult to do the survey.
How did you deal with condominium residents?
We go through a certain protocol. In a village, we go to the barangay captain, we go to the homeowners association. In the condo, we go to the building administrator. We have a letter coming from whoever to tell them we are here to conduct the survey. And pray that they will cooperate.
Sir, okay. Worst case scenario po, what if you were turned down by these participants? How were you able to choose another set of random participants to replace those who said no?
Yeah, again, we have to go through again the random. It's hard. We have to go to the random numbers again to choose the yung exactong. Oh, yes. It's hard. That's why we.
So you hop back to the same no.
Before the survey is conducted, we already have what we call reserves or possible replacements. So in case the dog succeeds, then we have to we have to replace, diba? So there's a rule at the beginning of, it's part of the survey planning to have the rule for replacement. The interviewer is not given any chance to choose. Or to decide for her. For
do you
himself.
Have a specific percentage po ng reserves na yon? 5%? Ilas na po talaga yon?
Depende sa expected non-response. For example, if you expect a 90% response rate, then you have reserves. But then may protocol din yan. Meron din yung rules. We make it hard for them.
Can I just add to what was shared? No? For all the comments that you received, I think the key word is replicability. No? Sabi nga natin, ang service ay scientific. Ang pagkaintindi po ng scientific ay kahit sinong gustong gumawa ng eksaktong question na yon, ay makukuha niya more or less the same percentages. Kung susundan lang, step by step, ang mga ginawa ng mga ng mga protocols ng SWS or Philippine Statistics Office. So for example, replacement, you pointed it out earlier, no? There are very precise, accurate procedures on how to replace a person. There's a sampling frame, there's a skipping pattern, there's a question to be asked, etc., etc. So it's a very rigorous process, and if you don't meet it, you're responsible, you're culpable. So reputation is at stake, which is why across the 185 countries that was studied by the University of Hong Kong in 2012, the number one question that journalists and media needs to ask is, who did the survey? Who did the survey? More than ano ba yung sample size, ano ba yung etc. Kasi everything and anything that rests on the methodology can be encapsulated by who did the survey. No? So, nandyan yan. Dapat may source yan, and therefore, he's answerable to anyone who wants to challenge the process.
Yes, please.
Yes, it also helps that all our interviewers are female. Mm-hmm. All our interviewers are female.
Uh-huh. Yes, yes. Sexist siya?
No, but...
gender sensitivity.
The household thinks, naku, baka magnanakaw ito. It might be a thief, a possible casing the house for a thief. No? So a natural fear of male interviewers. That's why we always use all females.
Yeah, the reason I ask is, we may have a petition from the LGBT for gender sensitivity, no? But that's another case. Let's talk about it later.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. I'm Juvie De Guzman of DWBL. To Mr. Dennis of SWS, have you heard about some people criticizing you of your result, especially when they said that it's not true, it's being paid by someone? Have you heard? How do you manage to interact on that case?
I assure you, that comes always kung may election time. That comes at every election time, seasonal. Okay, yes, it comes at every election time. So we just repeat what we say. It's our process. We're not for sale. We can't be corrupted. But regarding surprises, since we have the data, we can show ito yung pattern. In fact, if I may show, I'll the screen. Hold on. Other questions first.
Okay. Okay.
I'll just add to what Dennis added earlier. If a survey is something that's for the public, anyone can ask the survey researcher. So they're entitled to answer whatever question it is public wants to know. So.
Dagdagan ko din yung sinabi ni Nico. Yes. We have two kinds of surveys. One is commissioned, the other one is non-commissioned. Non-commissioned. So non-commissioned, meaning this is for public consumption. And the public is entitled to know how the survey was done. Okay. Now, for commissioned survey, this means that the results will be submitted to a client. The client may choose to make it public or not. Depended sa purpose ng survey. And the client can ask any question from the survey organization. But the survey organization cannot make it public without the permission of the client.
Okay. It's a code of ethics, no? Okay.
Regarding yung surprises, some people are surprised by the findings. But kami, knowing the data, we're not surprised. For example, take the case of Rojas and Binay, the race for the vice president in 2010. Back in December 2009, you see the big lead of Rojas over Binay, no? Rojas, the first leading, Binay was the last.
Yes.
That's why he was surprised. No, nanalo si Binay, surprised. What happened was, we saw a steady climb of Binay, diba? Rising. Finally, they're equal. And then finally, he overtook Rojas. So we who know the pattern are not surprised by it with the findings, because in this case it's a build-up, a steady and slow build-up.
So
this case.
How would you interpret that of Lauren's, Lauren Legarda's case?
Yeah, she went down. I don't know what issue put her down. No, I can't recall right now what put her down. But simply, I think the sheer campaigning of Binay. The point here is that if there's a crisis, if people are surprised, we in the survey business are not surprised because we see the long-term data.
Okay.
Second question.
Yes, please.
Are you related with the former president,
no.
Jimmy?
No. Yan pala ang itanong sa akin sa Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao.
Thank you very much.
He comes from Baaw, Camarines Sur. And he is a relative of then-Senator Joker Arroyo. Okay? Kaya tama yung introduction ko sa kanya sa isang event, the better Arroyo.
Are you using the same samples? And the different surveys that is
no, the same sample size but iba-ibang tao.
Iba-ibang tao.
The same sample size but different people. Yes.
Tess Ramiro from the Bloggers Association of the Philippines and the Catholic Media Network. Can you please go back to your previous? I have three questions actually. My first question is between SWS and Pulse Asia, do you talk between and among yourselves about the surveys? Whether professionally speaking or not.
No, we don't. Bawal.
You have different prices, I suppose.
I don't know what the prices are. I don't know what
when you have somebody conduct a survey, you would charge differently, more or less. Okay. Professionally speaking.
Do you
have a standard rate to follow? Like for instance, when you go to a doctor, consultants are usually from 600 to 1,000. Yes. So that's more or less standard in the industry of medicine.
Okay.
What about in surveys? Is there also a standard fee for particular surveys, whether national or local?
There's no standard industry fee between SWS and Pulse Asia. Walang common fee, no?
Kanya-kanya.
Regarding
this, I noticed that this is supposed to be the good grades in report cards.
Yes, okay. Then,
but if you notice, those with blanks, why were there blanks? I just want to understand.
In the survey, we didn't ask them that year. For example, March 15, we asked on environment, but hindi tinanong sa other surveys. Costs, saving money. Next, please, next slide. So my good, my moderate, then the next slide, my neutral, and then my poor. So yung report card for different things. So the first slide was good grades. The second was moderate grades. Ito neutral, and poor. Ito yung poor. The poor usually is the bottom is eradicating graft and corruption and fighting inflation, despite the low inflation.
Because if I were a non-researcher, a lay person, and please go back to the first one.
Yes.
And I look at the data. I would look at the issues. Mm. I would relate children's education with helping the poor and ensuring that medicines are affordable. Mm. When it leaves blank, it seems to me mukhang hindi priority ng government. That's one. Let me just continue. Okay. Second, why is it that helping victims of disasters, protecting the environments, and promoting human rights, halos parehong black, it would seem to me, as a layperson, hindi talaga priority ng gobyerno ang kalikasan. Because if you relate it to the actual situation, and this is the report card of the administration, as far as the surveys are concerned, I would conclude, therefore, that, and this was already expressed by the president himself, the environment issues are not his priority. And that is really killing the dumagats and the people fighting for environmental causes. What's your take on that?
Well, I can't speak for the presidency.
What about if you talk about the relationship? Because this became your, how do you call it, concerns. I don't know who even asked you to make that kind of a survey. But if you'd worked on these issues, what does this tell you, really? Because my third question would be, how do people in general react to your surveys as a way of giving you the feedback? Have you heard, for instance, that we don't believe in SWS anyway. Or even the Presidential Commission on Communications would tell, okay, the surveys are good, but we're not really bothered.
Yeah. We,
you know, those are reactions.
Okay. We, as a matter of courtesy, the first person to be briefed is the President of the Philippines. Whenever,
always.
Yeah, that's if you recall right, yes. Yeah, in a habit, are the first person to be briefed.
Even before you publish it in the newspapers.
Yes.
Okay, next. Okay.
Then I think, for example, mataas yung sa education because of the DepEd spending lately, yung more classrooms being built. And mataas yung sa happy na poor because of the CCT, Pantawid Pamilya. The human rights, I don't know. But they're good grades here. The one, I'll show you the really bad grade. Can you go down, no? Sige pa. Ito, the really bad is at the bottom, resolving the Maguindanao massacre case with justice. Minus 50, minus 57, very, very bad, extremely, extremely bad. Usually we got used to inflation or corruption of minus 4, minus 5, minus 8. But ito, Maguindanao, it's been dragging on and on and on. And so the people are mad why it hasn't been resolved. So very bad.
Okay. We have questions from Channel 9, from CNN Philippines, and probably from IBC 13. Yes.
Hi, I'm Joyce from CNN Philippines. Several questions for the pollsters. As of now, the presidential and even the vice presidential pre-election survey seem volatile. Parang the rankings change every so often. But do you see any, as early as now, can you tell who is most likely to win?
No, it's still volatile. No, can you go down? Sige, pakihanap yung go down. Sige pa, presidentials, down. Sige pa. Okay. Sige pa, next. Okay, you can see the lines. No, they really volatile. For example, December 2014, Binay was on top. The red line, then the blue line, Po was on top, then Rojas was on top, the Duterte
Rojas was consistent, no?
Duterte was on top. Well, Rojas
No, I'm saying it's consistent. No? That's what I saw.
Right. But yung latest snapshot, next please. Sige, that's in the vice president. So ito yung latest February 5-7, Binay 29, Grace Poe 24, Duterte 24, Rojas 18, Miriam 4. So it's still anybody's ball game at this point, no? May still a few months away, so we don't know.
Yes, please. Can I ask? May I also know if it's possible for SWS to show those who said, I won't vote, or I cannot vote, or I'm incapacitated to vote, among those who are in biometrics already?
Okay, it's possible, but Nicco Dela, I don't have the info right now with me. Okay.
Yeah. Kasama po ba sa tanong yun na tawasin ka man, iboboto mo ba ito o hindi? Kung tatawasin ka ba, iboboto mo ba yan? Hindi, kasama. Yes,
but at one point or at what month can the survey predict who will win?
No, okay, that'll be hard. No, if they're neck and neck, even we will be nervous because we can tell kung neck and neck. The most accurate of course would be the exit polls. That'll be the most accurate. No, but before that, yeah, and given this volatility we saw here. We don't know, eh? Kasi remember nung when Pinoy won, it was way ahead, so we could tell you'd win. No, but in this case, it's really volatile.
What are the factors which cause the surveys to be volatile?
Well, statements made in the press that they come out, fancy remarks or new allegations, cases of corruption, or any misstep can affect the ratings. No, any misstep or any good soundbite, they all matter. Eh? They all matter.
What about the presence of the spouse in the campaign?
Na,
not that I can't remember that being a factor. No, I mean I can't remember any data on that.
Will you not include that this time? Yeah.
You are apparently alluding to something.
No, anyway. Because you know, if there is a candidate whose better half is an American citizen, what does that make of the election laws? Because what has a foreigner got to do with the elections? That's one. Pero isang bagay doon, Professor, eh pwede pala dahil baka umulan ng magandang sapatos. You know? Mahal yun eh. And he can afford to buy the shoes.
Hindi na Nike.
Medyo Nike. Yeah.
I also would like to ask a question kay Dennis, no, as an interested party. Okay, meron silang, I don't know if we're, of course you guys are pollsters, you know better. But we kami naman, we have this term that that is actually a pollster term called peaking too early, sabi nila. This guy peaked too early, parang ganun. I remember in 2004, this is the case of Villar, di ba? Parang he peaked too early, and also I think
2010.
Yes. Now, how can you elaborate on this?
Ewan, can you go back a few slides? Okay. Ito yung the race for president in 2010, no? So the blue line is Aquino, the yellow line is Villar, red Estrada, then the latter in the lower Teodoro Villanueva and all that. So you can see Aquino being ahead, no? But Villar, it shows his rise and well, as you call it, peaking too early. He almost touched the Aquino line in February 2010. Now some issue may have torpedoed him. Okay, yeah.
Which the Villarroyo issue.
Is that it or
yeah.
Is that
Villarroyo.
C5. Yes. Yeah, so it's possible to peak too early, and it's possible to have an issue when you torpedo your chances.
Okay. Nahulog sa entablado. Yes, please.
Sir, something similar to that. Do you see anything similar or different, similarities or differences with the current election surveys as compared to the previous ones, previous election years? For example, sir, with Vice President Bina, you said that you were able to predict that he will eventually win despite his bad performance in the previous months. Right now, do you see that happening also in the vice presidential or presidential candidates?
Well, right now, our crystal ball is more clouded because napaka-volatile. Okay, they're all volatile for some reason. They're getting volatile. Another thing, unfortunately, we don't have any more the exit poll because you now have automated elections. It's now automated. So there's no point in having an exit poll if you can know the results very very quickly. So I don't think we'll have an exit poll.
But the question is if the votes will be counted accurately because there is no trace, there is no receipt to show that I voted for this candidate. Will be another case. Okay.
Last na talaga.
Please.
Kasi Senator Miriam is performing consistently very badly in the surveys. Yes. Does she still have a chance to catch up?
I won't make remarks regarding the chances, but she's been performing. I'll just say that she's been performing low in the ratings. That's all I can say.
Okay. Thank you.
Can you show us the race for the vice presidency this time? 2010 to. Yun lang muna ulap. Yung Binay. Sige, isa pa.
Okay.
Yeah, Escudero.
Okay, yan ang hindi yan ang latest. That's not the latest. That's till January. It shows Cheese, Escudero leading. Then you can see the green line. That's Marcos, Bongo Marcos. Also going up fast, Bongo Marcos. And Robredo also going up fast. Now, the next slide, sige, next please. Ito yung latest, 5 to 7, Binay, 29, President, sorry. Next pa. Marcos, 26. Escriero, 26. Robedo, 19. Yes, patay na sila. Alan Pedro Cayetano, 16. Onasan, 6. Tilianes, 5. That's the latest snapshot we have right now.
Do you think we still have the luxury of time to have a change in this ranking?
Yes. Pwede pa. Okay. It's now February instead of March, April, then early May.
So what should they do? Tutuloy ba sila sa ilaw ng flashlight para tumaas ang ratings?
No. You know, we have to ask the policy professor how to campaign.
Okay. Anyway, more questions from the audience? Yeah, from Vera Files. We're happy to have somebody from Vera Files.
Hi, good morning po. I'm Fiona Imperial from Verifiles, non-profit online media organization. So my question po is, you said kanina na we acknowledge the relevance of surveys in a democracy, but we also acknowledge that many things are being done in its name. So how do we encourage the public to be skeptical in assessing surveys? Because you said a while ago that there is a plethora of bad surveys, especially on social media.
Yes, we have to look for those which are scientifically done. And by scientific, yes, I would include SWS, Pulse Asia, Trends of Under Mercy, Lilo Survey. And in general, those under the MORES. The MORES is the Marketing and Opinion Research Society, under those surveys. Now, under bad surveys, online, because you can repeat your votes, you can click as often as you want.
As I mentioned earlier, we're going around the country, no? Nasa NCR kami, Baguio, next week, Cagayan de Oro, Iloilo, just last week. And we need to work with you. We need to work with media. Because media are the ones who present the survey results. On our side, we police our ranks. So MORES members are mandated to abide by the Code of Ethics, which in turn abides by a worldwide Code of Ethics, which is SMR and WAPOR. No? I'm sure Dennis is aware of this. No? They're a WAPOR member. In statistics, they abide by the Philippine Statistics Authority Association Code of Ethics. Okay. So on our side, I think we're taking care of things, but your point is, how do we educate the public? This is where we need to partner with you. And to partner with you, we have to agree on what are the mandatories that needs to be reported to the public. Number one, source of survey. Number two, what question was asked in the survey? We were told that the public was confused, no? Parang early part last month, na why is this candidate ahead of another candidate when historically mababa yung isa? It turns out the question that was asked were different. Now you ask us, who's culpable? Is it the researcher or the client? I think neither, because the client has the right to ask the question that he needs to decide on. It's like asking, what's the best brand for you today? It's like, who will you vote for today, no? Versus, I want to know which of the three brands are good for you today. That's totally different, that's oceans apart. And yet, if you ask the second question, it brings the ranking way up, parang light years away. Biglang magja-jump siya ng ganon. So, I mentioned source of survey, ask, sampling, sample size, for example, etc., etc. Anyway, we have a whole list which we presented to the Philippine Press Institute that will guide the media.
Maybe you can share with us part of your presentations as well. Yeah.
Melo, on the part of those who would say that they are conducting government surveys, we can ask them to produce their IDs and to see the questionnaire. The questionnaire should have a clearance number coming from PSA. That shows that it has undergone review. I have also experienced being the attempts on the part of some marketing people to conduct surveys. sabihin, may pa-survey ho kami, pa-census. Tatanong ko naman, may I see the questionnaire? So it turns out they're selling fire extinguishers. Ganun pala, no? So it's our right to ask them to identify themselves, what organization they represent, and to see the questionnaire. Yun naman.
Melo?
Yes, please.
In a related matter that I think is could also be important, especially in the appreciation of surveys in electoral contests or electoral... I believe there is a parang, just thought of it now, a three-step process. Like SWS, Pulse Asia, and say LILO would release the survey results. And then it's another thing for how the media would present that result and the political analyst that would be... Normally it's like that, di ba? Meron, okay, kasama po natin si like Melo Acuna or to analyze or to talk about it. So there's this, that's the rub. There's the rub. It's not actually the... It's a different thing when you just release it. Then it's another process or another... how would you call it? Another step or another...
Approach.
No.
Okay.
It's how you interpret it.
Yes.
So in the case po of some online organizations actually have informal polls sa parang sa side ng sites nila. So do you recommend that? I mean, even online media organizations, some online media organizations like parang who is your bet?
In a word, no.
Ganun lang kasimple. Okay. What's your prediction? What would... Still have another question? Sige, we'll give way.
One of the criticisms for this elections, and I think for all the previous elections, but I'm a first-time voter, so don't really know.
Very so, young lady.
Anyway, ayun. Ayun po. One of the criticisms is that the level of the electoral discourse is really low. I mean, it revolves on personalities rather than issues, rather than platforms. It revolves on people, on mudslinging, and on the issue of election surveys. So, who tops the election surveys, who is consistent, something like that. So, is this affected by the quality of our surveys? Or how does this, parang ano po yung direct influence doon sa level of our electoral discourse, and how can it help elevate that?
Well, at least now the discourse is being elevated because we had last night, yung, diba, we had this debate. Okay, yesterday, then you have more debates coming for Visayas and Mindanao, Luzon, no? So that will help elevate the discourse. And it's also really also up to media to try to laymanize the issues, because you have otherwise, you have what you call intellectual dynasties. That is, you have an intellectual A writing research, which is read only by intellectual B, intellectual C, and D, dynasties, no? They must go down to the people, yung masa. So it's up to the media to laymanize the issues, to help them digest the issues so that they can vote wisely and discuss intelligently.
Thank you very much, Paul.
Okay, thank you. It's nice to know that we have a millennial with us this morning, you know? Congratulations. Millennial, batang-bata, you know? Eh, kasi kami, inabot namin, hindi lang Nutriban. Yung nauna pa sa Nutriban ni Grace po. Yung relief ng Cooperative American Relief everywhere. Let's look forward. Nagsalita yung isang matanda. Let's look forward. Ano po nakikita ninyo sa nalalabing bahagi ng campaign season? Madam Bobby, from an expert on statistics, where will they make their presence felt?
Actually, hello. Kanina, papunta ako dito, nakikinig ako doon sa debate. I was listening to the debates, which was replayed this morning at the radio, AM radio. You know what station it is, no? Because that's the one who conducted it. So I was listening to that debate. I look forward to more of it. Before election, so that we will be informed
about their views and about their plans in case they become president. And what their stand will be on certain issues that are important to us. So, well, the pollsters will also try to predict who will win. Although at this time, when people ask me, because I also have a small survey firm, but we do small area surveys rather than national surveys for now. Who will win? I don't know why they ask us as if we were equipped with crystal balls and able to look in the future. So asking us to predict who will win. Everything is volatile, as you could see in the data. So we look forward to more confusion.
From the survey firms, from Juarez.
What do we expect in the coming months?
Okay. Our view, kasi, from the ongoing polls is that nothing from the data can be used to predict. That's it. Nothing from the polls that you see can be used to predict. Parang that's the long and the short of it. Why? Kasi ang surveys, it's like a thermometer. Eh. You dip it in a cup of coffee, you know the temperature. For today, for this particular second, here in Aristocrat Restaurant. That's it. May aircon tayo dito. Okay, take it out. If it, for example, consistently goes up, does it mean that tomorrow it will still go up? Probably yes, but tomorrow there could be a brownout. Aristocrat and my thermometer will tell me it's just room temperature, 24 degrees. Exactly the same thing here. As you said, as we agreed earlier, a survey is a fantastic tool for taking samples for the trade-offs that we're willing to give because we don't have 2.6 billion for a census, right? So the long and the short of it is that if, for example, today candidate X is winning, on May 9, it could be totally different because someone might spring something different, no? Which might make the electorate think differently, okay? So ganun din po sa marketing. Just to correct myself earlier, no, as a marketing, some clients do have funds to do like census type surveys, no, telcos for example, no, they have huge face to face or big data, may mga big data sila. It's not just a face to face surveys, meron silang images online, they have sound, you know, technologies on their side, no. So that's my view on what. This lang, sir. Okay, I was mentioning earlier that we have to work hand in hand with media, preferably media who understands why we do surveys. And by SMR and WAPOR guidelines, the mandatory information that's actually being asked from media or presenters to show whenever they show survey results are the first 8 items. Normally, we just have the research agency, if at all. But look at number one. Number one, dapat it's clearly stated in quotes what question was asked. Then number two, what is the name of the research agency? Because that shows the reputation of who's conducting the research. And then what is the universe represented? Are you representing the entire electorate or just Luzon? Diba? And then you have the achieved. Not just the sample size, but yung achieved sample size. Usually it's rounded off. But by SMR standards, compared the achieved sample size. No? And then the survey period. That in itself is a rich source of information. No? Kasi kanina when the chart was being flashed by SWS, you saw the survey periods, and you put it side by side by Asia, Pulse Asia, for example, and nagkakaiba pala sila ng weeks. And that's a source of difference. Another thing is something must have done around that week that the strategy sprung on the constituents. No? So you will probably know why the change. Number seven, and I don't see this except for some research on media, no, sa CNN. You don't know or will not vote. No, normally hindi siya nilalagay, but that's a very important source of swing votes. Yung don't know, tsaka those who will not vote, yung undecided, no? And then for the media, this is also important. If the survey is an omnibus, because if the survey is an omnibus, then you're entitled to call SWS. You're entitled to call Pulse Asia. How they did the survey and what are the details here, no? And then you have the preferred but not mandatory, no? Yung sampling method, di ba? If you do quota sampling, yan, there's a science behind it. Kung probability, there's a science behind it. Now, delicado, or you have to be careful if the surveyor says we did non-probability, no? But we're not saying it's wrong. There could be reasons why they did it, no? You're just cautious. And then the interview method, we're lucky in the Philippines that we still can do face-to-face interviews, no? In other countries, wala na silang pera, no? Telephone na lang sila. They don't know who's on the other side of the line. And then who's the type of client of the survey? Is it the media? Okay, like yesterday, GMA, di ba? Ano sila? And then it could be a research agency, it could be a strategist, it could be a politician. Now, if it's the latter part, then you should be cautious kasi it's prone to push polling. And lastly, the margin of error. We do the public a service by showing them on the main trade-off in terms of the margin of error, because statistical tie is, you know, nagdikit sila by plus minus 2%. You don't necessarily have to say one candidate is above 2% when they're within the statistical limit, no? Now plus minus 4%, for example. So that's...
Dennis, let me ask you, if somebody dies, will it influence election results? Let's say the mother of a candidate dies. You know, because in the Philippines, we have what we call necropolitics.
It depends on whose mother.
Or your spouse, no? Okay. So let's look at it very objectively. What do you see in the coming months before elections?
It's still volatile at this point. No, I'm sorry, I can't say anymore because yeah, it's volatile. Eh. They're going up and down. So it's too early to call. It's early to call the results. We'll know only late in the game, around May or late April. Right now, you can see the swings. They're wild.
Yeah, it's still volatile, right? Volatile. Yes, madam.
It would still be useful to do an exit poll. Even if it's automated.
Okay, so we need funding for that, eh?
You need funding?
Yeah, for exit polls, yes. I don't know, not the 2 billion, no, not the 2.6 billion, but yeah, but the point is, it'll need funding, and who will fund us if you know the results, you know, the day after already? That's automated.
Yeah. Thank you. What do you see? Will they throw everything at each other, including the toilet sink? What will happen? Will there be mudslinging?
Well, debates, but it's not actually a debate. The truth is, I was sort of using the local parlance, parang biten, no? I mean, they were all in a very jovial mood with each other, very diplomatic, and far from a debate. And they were part of a mutual admiration society. Okay. Hopefully next time, I think there will be two debates more. Hopefully it will be a real debate, a longer one. Maybe the format could be reformatted, no? Tsaka parang it's and the commercials are far too many, and the commercials were also included the political ads. So hopefully next time they would have to rethink or
If I were a candidate. Yes. And I was not doing very well in the survey, what would you advise me do to increase my ratings?
Depending on the candidate. I mean, are you referring to... Okay.
Let's say I am a candidate for...
Work harder, because you see you have only 90 days. And 90 days, so that's what? There's a specific period of time. Yeah. Where we can work on.
Yeah, excluding Good Friday and Black Saturday.
Maybe 70 days to go. Am I correct?
78 days as of yesterday.
Something like that. So, 80 days. So, that's how many hours a day we should, let's focus on areas that we have missed or we have, you know, normally by late March, there will be some trend already. Not necessarily a prediction, but some sort of a trend that we can see.
Okay. Yes, madam.
If I were a candidate in the first place, before the survey, I would ask the survey organization to ask certain questions about what the issues are, what do they like about me, or what do they not like about me.
Probably the spouse.
Well, if it's the spouse, then... So, and then, so if you will ask me what I will do about it, if the survey says the spouse, I will send the spouse on a long vacation or somewhere.
Not necessarily file for divorce because Catholic Church will not accept that, no?
Yeah, basta bakasyon muna siya.
Okay.
Somewhere.
All right. So, dapat pala itanong din kung ano yung dapat na isyong bigyan.
Oh.
Okay, yeah. Very well. Would you care to add anything more, guys? Nothing more? Yes.
As an addition to Bobby, you know, strategists will have to make the best use of the data that they have right now. Look at the weakness at this point. Look at the strengths. Position it. Recheck if your still positioning is still sound. If it's no longer sound, put it in a garbage and then redraw it.
And probably throw in the towel, just as Jeb Bush did yesterday. Okay. So, Sky. Paano? Papaalam na tayo.
Mukhang mahaba-haba ang discussion natin today. So, maraming salamat po sa ating mga guests. At medyo marami akong natutunan na when it comes to surveys. Kasi ako, hindi pa ako na-survey. Hindi ko pa siya naranasan eh.
Ganun.
Ikaw ba naranasan?
Hindi. Hindi pa rin ako na-survey. I'd like to say thank you to our friends from SMNI TV 39, CNN Philippines, PTV 4, IBC 13, and Global News Network. They took time to be with us today. I received an email from our good friend from the Japanese embassy. He's just tied up. He couldn't make it today, but he looks forward to joining us next time and have coffee with Amir and Maslisa. So next week, we'll try to talk about foreign policy. How do we deal with the South China Sea and several other related issues? So, yan ang agenda natin for next week sa Tapatan sa Aristocrat. Have a nice day. God bless us all. Thank you. Thank you.